good evening, good afternoon, and good morning to all the viewers around the world. It gives me immense pleasure to host today's e-seminar. I, Manisha Singh, on behalf of Progressive Literary and Cultural Society, welcome you all and the dignitaries and scholars gracing this occasion. Today's topic for discussion is the psychological concussion of gender inequality on a woman in Sharon Pollock's Blood Relation. The moderator of today's event is Shaista Sadiq. Shaista Sadiq is from Rajouri, Jammu and Kashmir. She is a postgraduate from Central University of Jammu, pursuing her PhD. Shaista, now over to you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, and good evening. Welcome to today's session, that is PCS team. Today's session we are having about the Canadian literature, and we will discuss various themes and various prominent writer of Canada. Canadian writing is one of our multicultural. Of course, we have America as a multicultural nation, but Canada is the first country who has brought the nation. And moreover, in America, we have this melting point that is assimilating many cultures to become a one culture. The metaphor we use for this Canadian as a salad bowl, that is assimilating and of course retaining each culture. Whenever we talk about Canada, we speak about geography, and it's the smallest country after Russia, and it has it has population like Ethiopia. In Canadian literature, we have writers like Alice Munn, first writer who has received this Nobel Prize. From Canada, Fred Atwood, who was shortlisted for Booker Prize for three times and finding it in 2000. So Canada has this wide themes. It has a theme of survival, theme of crisis of identity, because it was colony of France and Britain, and thus it has two languages. One is French and second is English. So whenever we talk about Canada, we also talk about new colonialism, because it has been America, and thus we talk about the garrison mentality. It has garrisoned the opinion of Canadian writers, and there are also various other themes, but we will discuss the various important novels from The Blind Assassin, Before Man, Cat's Eye, The Irrible Women, The Handmaid's Tale by Margaret Atwood. And for the session, we have speaker Dr. Shamnaz. Dr. Shamnaz is author, co-author, editor, translate 19 international books, which includes poetry, literary articles, criticism, and travelogue. The test book is a short story, The Jasmine Girl and Other Stories. Being a prolific she holds a DPhil in English, University of Allahabad, India, with a special in South Asian women writers, Indian culture, and new literature. She has published in many international magazines and journals all over. She is currently teaching English literature at Rishi Tandon Mahila Mahak, Allahabad. She has taught English English Lit and Language at SS Khanna Girls Degree College, Allahabad University, Communications Gilbert Institute of Engineering and Technology. She has professional experience for more than 17 years. She has 70 research papers in national and international journals across the globe and has presented papers in national and seminar conference all over India. She is a member of editorial board of journals including KJHSS from Azerbaijan and IJRHS Jordan and Cyber Literature and online the context English literary research itself and expressions. She is the founder and president of Progressive Literary and Cultural Society, an international organization for the promotion of the global literature and culture. Now I welcome Dr. Shahnaz to carry this session forward.
Thank you so much, Shaista, for such a wonderful introduction. I thank you all for being with me in today's lecture. Coming to Canadian literature, as Shaista has discussed some themes, topics related with Canadian literature. When I was a student, then at that time Canadian literature was not so popular in our place or in India, and so at that time I did not read any thing related with Canadian literature. Though we have, barring British literature, we have read American literature, we have read Irish literature, a little bit of African literature we have known, but we did not read anything related with Canadian literature. But recently, when new literature was inculcated in the syllabus of PG courses in Allahabad University, then the literature of Australia, New Zealand and Canada and African and Caribbean was introduced in the first and second semester of PG courses. So at that time, I read some women writer or male writer also of Canada, like earlier I have read something related with Margaret Atwood, some some research paper, but I have not worked on this writer. Like Margaret Atwood is very much famous in India, all over India lots of work has been carried out, so I was just familiar with Margaret Atwood. But when I started teaching, I read Sharon Pollack, Alice Munro. Sharon Pollack has a very different style of writing drama. As we all familiar with Alice Munro, she is a Nobel awardee, and her thrillers are very popular. She has a writing style which is based on suspense, like The Love of a Good Woman is a fine example of it, which has won a Nobel Prize also. Then these three, I became very fond of Canadian literature, and I started loving these writers, whether it was Sharon Pollack or Alice Munro or Margaret Atwood. Then there was also a writer, George Riga. I read his drama, The Ecstasy of Rita Jew. That was about the exploitation of Red Indians still being continued in Canada, though lots of revolution and other things have been going on. Still, this native, the issue of native people are still there in whether it is Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. That the native people have still not got the respect or identity which they deserve in their own country, and the settlers have overpowered them. So, coming to Sharon Pollack, she is a writer which has focused basically on Canadian theatre. Her study of Lizzie Borden's and this drama, Blood Relation, is based on real incident. It was more than 100 years back, a twin murder case happened in which a girl killed her own father and her stepmother. So how, and in she was very innocent girl, she used to love animals, birds, and how an innocent girl became a murderer because of certain circumstances. She became a victim of circumstances and she committed the heinous crime of committing the murder. So this drama is all about, and Sharon Pollock was successful in making the character of Lizzie Borden. She has presented the character of Lizzie Borden in such a way, if anybody will read it, you will feel sympathy for her. So coming to the topic of this lecture, the psychological conclusion of gender equality on a woman, how psychology affect a woman, how psychology or circumstances can force a woman or compel a woman to do murder or do things against her wish. So the psychological conclusion of gender equality on a woman, Sharon Pollock blood relation. So I will be talking about the psychological effect on gender in respect of Sharon Pollock's drama blood relation. So as we know, every individual is controlled by his/her psyche, and it is the human psyche which controls the entire body and our action. Carl Jung, the philosopher and psychologist, has propounded the theory of the collective unconsciousness, in which he has explained anima and animus as part of a school of analytical thought. He believed that both male and female gender possess trait of the opposite gender. Means some women have some trait of males and males have some traits of women. In an unconscious state, a woman has a masculine side which is called animus, and man's unconscious feminine side known as anima. Adverse circumstances many a time may affect an individual's psyche and compel him or her to do things which are not in his or her control. Many authors have time and again have focused on the inner working of mind in their writing, and blood relation by Canadian dramatist Sharon Pollock is a fine example of such work. It is based on the famous twin murder case that happened in England in 1892 and is considered a masterpiece, especially for depicting the psychological state of mind of the protagonist, Lizzie Borden. The play Lizzie Blood Relation, which premiered for the first time in 1980, has won many accolades, including the Canadian Governor General Award. Lizzie Borden, the central figure of the play, is charged with the heinous crime of murdering her father and stepmother. The speculation surrounding her life is dealt in a fine way by Pollock, making her victim of circumstances and thus arousing sympathy among the audience for her. Means she is presented Lizzie Borden in such a way, if anybody will read, he or she will feel sympathy for her. The most important reason for the murder is the insecurity of a female about her future, because she is living in a society which does not give equal right on the basis of gender. Means more than 100 years back, the Canadian society was also patriarchal. At that time, women were not given right, basic right of working or other need. The play is based on the case of Lizzie Borden, which gained enough media coverage back in 1892. The incident occurred on August 4th of that year. Borden's father's body was discovered by Lizzie in a downstairs room of the family home. Soon the Borden's maid Sullivan discovered the body of Borden's stepmother also. It was followed by subsequent investigation and trial of Lizzie, because she was held guilty of the crime. She was arrested for murder and the trial date set for June 5, 1893. This public trial, which caused a national sensation, though at that time there was no media coverage like we have today and also no social media, but still it became a national sensation and lasted for 14 days. Media played a key role and covered extensively by but her lawyer presented the case very cleverly and they were able to rescue her. Even feminist and animal rights advocate also supported her, but though she was she did not get punishment from the court, but society held her guilty. The popular opinion on the innocence or guilt of Lizzie Borden was debated. Some people thought that she was guilty, but some people considered her as innocent. Due to the efforts of lawyer, Lizzie Borden was acquitted, who persuaded the jury that the evidence was circumstantial. After the trial, she continued to live in Fall River in a fashionable Victorian mansion located on the hill with her sister, her elder sister. But since she was understandably shunned by the community, hence she continued to live a life of social circumscription, even more limited than before the murder. Today also in our society, if a woman commit crime, she is not accepted by the society. Though this the same does not imply for men also, but in those days Canada also had the same society. At the same time, she also lived a luxurious life, traveling regularly, however maintaining a relationship with a young Boston actress named Nance O'Neill. In this drama, Sharon Pollock has also shown the lesbian way of lesbian side of Lizzie Borden, which provoked yet more rumors and resulting in Emma finding her own place to live. After her death in 1927, she was buried in the Borden family plot. Shannon Pollock was very much influenced by this twin murder case. She studied and traced the new discoveries in it, and then she authored Blood Relations. This play is considered as one of her best work because she depicted the psychological state of the protagonist and how circumstances affect an innocent woman, making her completely different from what she was. As Pramod K. Nair has explained Jungian collective consciousness, he says, Jung treated the human self as the totality of all psychic processes. Pollock has portrayed Lizzie Borden's character as a victim of circumstances, leading the audience and reader to feel sympathy towards her. This is quite similar to our Indian Bollywood movies where heroes are characterized in a similar way. Like for example, the movie Sanju, in which Sanjay Dutt was shown Sanjay Dutt negative side or grey, black side or grey side was shown. Still, it was very popular and was commercially hit. Actually, it is true that she was an innocent girl, a lover of birds and animal. But due to certain changes in the situation, she committed the heinous crime of killing her own family member. Now, the question arises, why a girl with such a tender heart can do such a crime? The answer is due to her insecurity. If we delve into the story, we can easily find the answer. The play is interwoven with the story of three main characters, Lizzie Borden, the actress, and Emma. While the others, like her father, mother, Harry, Dr. Patrick, etc., have key role to play in the story. Lizzie Borden, the main character, had a tragic life as her mother died in her childhood. Her stepmother treated her badly, and her own father, being highly influenced by his wife, shunned her from his property. Her stepmother was very shrewd, who slowly captured the heart of Lizzie's father and sister, but she was not able to convince Lizzie. In front of her, she used to show her real self that made Lizzie agitated, but she felt miserable as she was not able to convince her father and her elder sister against her stepmother. This anger further erupted in a dangerous way. Mary E. A. Kite, K. Dukes, and Elizabeth H. Haynes have opined, I quote, "Emotions are believed to be at once gender segregated and one and more firmly associated with femininity. That is, women are believed to be both experience and express a broader range of emotion than are men. Although two emotions, anger and pride, are more strongly associated. These two emotion, anger and pride, are mostly associated with men in our society, as women are, as I read in one of Shashi Deshpande's novels, one of the characters speak that anger makes a woman unwomanly. This is the criteria of society, that they don't like women who have anger. They like women who are meek, calm, submissive. So Lizzie didn't receive love and support from her family, and hence she felt lonely and painful, making her frustrated and dejected. This resulted in making her rebel, who didn't feel remorseful even after twin murder of her stepmother and father. Being rejected by her father and stepmother, she turned toward her sister and Dr. Patrick, her lover, but both of them rejected her, making her a rebel. She was craving for love and care, and nobody gave respect and due love to her, resulting in making her a trapped victim. Lizzie was living in an environment which was not conducive, because the bonds of love and care for which an individual craved from a family was missing in her life, resulting in making her victims of circumstances. She committed twin murder, but she didn't feel remorseful about it, as she felt she was justified in her act. One important aspect which Pollack has highlighted in this play is the marginalization of Canadian women a century before. In those days, women in Canada were not liberated as they are in the current scenario. They were not economically independent or financially strong. Their freedom was confined till parties and picnics. As we see the opinion of scholar in the book, I quote, "Researchers have expanded our understanding of gender-based stereotype by identifying other dimensions that perceivers use to categorize women and men. Men and women are thought to occupy distinct societal roles. For example, men are viewed as leaders, financial provider, and heads of household, while women are seen as caregivers who shop, tend the house, and provide emotional support." Unquote. The play Blood Relation is relevant in the present scenario also, as it focuses on the psychological state of a person deprived of love and care. In our current fast-paced changing society, youth are becoming less tolerant and are lacking patience. The example of Sushant Singh Rajput, who died last year, is also one of the examples. This is the reason we see more cases of suicide and extremism. Further, it is also affecting health, as science has proved that psychological disorders even lead to some disease like gastric, respiratory, hypertension, skin diseases, or cardiovascular diseases. The faulty behavioral pattern lead to some peculiar traits which make an antisocial or rebel personality, just like Lizzie Borden. We see in our society, in high society, in elite classes, in metro city, when children are being deprived of love and attention from their parents, they are involving in the use of drugs or other criminal activities. Such people don't regret their crime, such as Lizzie Borden in Blood Relation. She did not regret killing her own parents. One of the most confusing and surprising disorder is that in which an individual who otherwise seems to be normal lack in conscience development and fail to develop any feeling of warmth or loyalty to other family member, which is very harmful. Once Lizzie wanted to kill herself because she thought that her stepmother is taking everything from her. Actually, Lizzie and her sister, they were not married. And in those days in Canada, property was not given to the daughters or to female member. So her mother was giving all the property or making her younger brother heir of the property. So in this way, she was taking everything from Lizzie and her sister. And so this means that after her father, that she will be left with nothing, and then she will have to live on the mercy of stepmother and his brother, and her brother. In such a situation, her life will be hell. So better to end it, and hence she wanted to commit suicide. But Lizzie decides she should not kill herself, as she says, I quote, "I want to die, I want to die, but something inside won't let me." Inside, something says no. She shuts her eyes. "I can do anything," unquote. This is the time when she decides that she will not kill herself, rather she will kill those people who are snatching her happiness. And then she decides that she would kill those who snatching her happiness from her and not herself. Pollack has applied dream technique through Miss Lizzie's psychological attitude reflected through her dreams, the dream of mass and the scene which heightened the impact of climax with her father axe murder of the bird, which became the turning point in persuading her for committing horrible murder. Actually, in this drama, Sharon Pollack has used dream technique, means she is talking about past and then present. She is taking us to the past, then again she is taking us to the present. Lizzie, a spinster, wanted to preserve her inheritance because for it, it was a symbol of independence and which she didn't want to lose. So she felt frustrated when her father decided to give it to her stepmother, stepmother's brother. At this stage, she wanted her sister to support her in saving their property. But Emma resisted because Emma was not so familiar with the cunning side of her stepmother, leading Lizzie to take a firm step in this regard, either suicide or murder. She struggled between the two choices and ultimately decided murder over suicide. From this point, murder is no longer a fantasy for Lizzie, and after undergoing mental turmoil, and she takes the hard decision of killing her father and stepmother. The dramatist has presented one incident after another in a chain. At the same time, she has woven thinking pattern in such a way that the audience and reader are swept with emotion and are compelled to sympathize with Lizzie, even for her murder, even for committing, the reader or audience have not held her guilty for the crime which she has committed. There is a play within play. An actress who plays Lizzie sometimes shuts her eyes and opens them to say her word, "I can do anything." Thus, the play Blood Relation can be termed as the presentation of the struggle between the inner conscience and the rebellious power in a very sensitive way. The character of Lizzie is presented before the reader as a person with stronger will power who is able to win over her inner conscience. She, being a part of patriarchal society, wanted to achieve emancipation in her life. She struggled hard because of her stepmother's vices and vile method. Her father and sister were under the influence of her stepmother, so they didn't supported her. This made her emotionally insecure and broken. She diverted her emotion toward Dr. Patrick, but he too failed to give her emotional gratification. Being emotionally devastated from all sides, she get wild and mad to achieve her free will. Lizzie needed emotional support from her family, but neither her father nor her sister gave warmth she needed as a family, leading her to the path of crime. Had things been different, she would have not committed the heinous crime of murdering her own family member. Lizzie's father is a person who is not able to reach to her daughter in terms of the emotional security she needed. This is what Sharon Pollack has highlighted in this play, making Lizzie a victim of circumstances, leaving reader with no other option than sympathizing her. The struggle, desperation and longing for the love of Lizzie are quite visible from the beginning of till the end of the play. It is this longing for love which lead Lizzie to find love in actress later on in her life. The play doesn't end with the twin murder case, but the story extends 10 years later in 1902 when Lizzie becomes a powerful woman with only Emma and actress by her side, as she was socially boycotted by the society due to murder. So the situation completely changed after 10 years. Now she was an emancipated woman. With the entry of actress, the relation between Lizzie and Emma worsened, because Emma was against her relationship with actress. Pollock has applied the technique of play within the play, resulting in a role reversal as Lizzie becomes the maid Bridget and actress play the role of Lizzie. Actually, it was Bridget who was a witness of the murder, but somehow Lizzie convinced her. But later on, after 10 years, Lizzie and actress sometimes used to play the part of Bridget and Emma, means Bridget and Lizzie. At that time, Lizzie used to become Bridget, her maid, and the actress used to become Lizzie. This technique of play within the play is also termed as dream thesis. In it, Lizzie enacted the enactment of 2 days of the year 1892, leading to the twin murder. In this enactment, other characters, including Emma, are not much needed, while actress is completely absorbed in the Borden's household, occupying each and every detail. This dream thesis also reflects the emotional bonding between Lizzie and actress. People often consider them as lovers, but actually the affair is based on the actress' own imagination woven with complexities. But the emotional bonding between actress and Lizzie gives courage to actress to ask a direct question about murder, did you, which nobody has earlier asked from Lizzie, even her sister also. Lizzie finds it's difficult to respond to such inevitable question and hence play the game with her. The actress, after playing the role of Lizzie, becomes so engrossed in the character by the second act that she forgot her own identity and becomes Lizzie. She was so carried away by her own performance that she forgot that it is just a performance and she is not Lizzie Borden. When she realizes, she questioned her, Lizzie, you did, but Lizzie denied it and doesn't accept actress version. Instead, she asks actress, I didn't, you did. These are the dialogue which make this play a very strong play, emotionally very strong. So this was an emotionally charged situation where Lizzie, being swept away by emotion, admitted her crime, which she has hidden from the world for 10 years and has not even told to her sister Emma. She has always been in dilemma about her status in her family, which is quite evident in actress Lizzie's conversation with Mr. Borden. I am supposed to be a mirror. I am supposed to reflect what you want to see. But everyone wants something different. If no one looks in the mirror, I am not even there. I don't exist, unquote. In her own family, she was feeling neglected, and this resulted in insecurity, which further forced her to take the drastic step of killing. The immediate cause being the killing of her pet birds by hatchet by her father in front of her eyes. She was very fond of her pets. She had some pets bird in her house, which she loved very much, and in an anger, her father killed those birds. So she thought that if my father has killed these birds and he is not remorseful, that I can also kill my father. And means killing is not wrong at that time, she thought. So in her own family, she was being neglected. The immediate cause being the killing of the bird by her father in front of her eyes. This scene has a very adverse effect on Lizzie. Either her father, in the spell of his manipulated second wife, wanted to transfer the farm to his brother-in-law instead of his daughter. This was the condition of Canadian society a century ago, that daughters were not given a share in father property, as the property was transferred to the male heir. One by one, all these incidents captured her innocent mind, dividing her personality into two beings. At one self, she was an innocent girl deeply in love with her father, but at the other self, she was confused, insecure, vulnerable girl who was trying to rebel against her uneven situation. Many continuous incidents provoked her and made her angry. As researchers believe, when women do express anger, perceiver infer that this expression is a combination of anger and sadness. So mainly women are angry only most of the time because they are sad. They are sad because they are not able to live their life according to their wish, and many times male member of the family impose their will on them. This is quite true in Lizzie's context because she was sad and isolated. The game played by Lizzie and actress helped them in realizing the unexpected and profoundly troubling recognition. By this, she also realizes that her friend, in a state of trauma, has killed her own family member. This confusion is made in the last line of the play. Actress also felt that she must have done the same thing in such a critical situation. Lizzie adopted free choices, maneuvering her altered ego. She made herself a distant personality than what she was earlier, from an innocent girl to a murderer. But at this juncture of time, her relation with her sister Emma stumbled. It was Emma who looked after Lizzie after their mother died. So when abruptly she came face to face with her and experiencing the terrifying moment of self-antipathy, in which she doesn't remain Lizzie but becomes someone else, and recognizes Emma as the manipulator when she says, "Your hand," I quote, "your hand working my mouth, me saying all the things you felt like saying, me doing all what you liked me." Lizzie, unquote, Lizzie charges her elder sister for everything, for her, all her wrongdoing. I quote, "Did you never stop and think that if I did, then you were guilty too? It was you who brought me up like a mother to me, almost like a mother. Did you ever stop and think that I was like a puppet, your puppet, my head, your hand, yes, your hand working my mouth, me saying all the things you felt like saying, and me doing all the things you felt like doing, me spewing forth, me hitting out, and you," unquote. She said these words in hysteria or in an emotionally charged situation. But these words also compel the audience to think about Lizzie's life and reason, forcing her to commit such crime with fresh eyes. The confrontation at the ending of the play gives it a different outlook than previously assumed, a sermon against the subjection of women, which was expected to be the scenario in 1892. The past and present structure of the play urges reader to think over the character and incident again and again in a logical or sometimes in an emotional way. People sometimes think it in a logical way, sometimes they become emotional. Actress too realizes that Lizzie committed murder to liberate herself from the shackle of patriarchy, and she felt that she would have done the same thing if she was there in place of Lizzie. But ultimately, the question is whether Lizzie has achieved her freedom or not. Or if she has achieved her freedom, she has achieved on account of killing her own family member. Through the play, Blood Relation, Pollock has raised many issues of vital importance. First is the legal law of inheriting property, which though has no relevance in Canada as for now, because the society has completely changed as compared to a century back. But the issue is significant in many parts of the world where women are deprived of property, even in our country as well. We see in many parts of the world, the property is being transferred to the male heir from one generation to other. This is a stereotype notion prevalent in the society where women are considered as incapable to look after the property. I quote, "Stereotypes are not simply labels but are assumptions about traits and behavior." As Kite said, another issue raised in the play is the lesbian relationship, which though has been legalized in many countries, but still in many Asian countries there is hostility towards such relationship, and society doesn't accept it. And the third issue is the rejection of society towards female criminal, as women are always accepted as gentle women. Then in this way, she has also highlighted the dependency of female on male members of their family. Many scholars have identified two principal dimensions, believe that women are concerned with the welfare of other people, which is labeled expressive or communal, and believe that men are assertive and controlling. This is also labeled instrumental or agentic. The condition of females of Canadian society a century before, which Pollock has portrayed, is also the current fate of women in many society around the world, like for example in Middle Eastern country. Women are considered secured within the four walls of the houses. Covey suggests, I quote, "Women as women are not located within the family. Rather, it is the family as an effect of kinship structure that women as women are constructed, defined within and by the group," unquote. No matter women have progressed so much in every field around the world, but they are still identified by their male family member. This is why many crimes against women are still prevalent in our society. Even if we see the example of our society recently, one of the girl became the victim of dowry case, and she herself committed suicide because she was continuously exploited by her husband and in-laws family. Researchers have argued that women, for example, are viewed as more emotional, gentle, understanding and devoted, whereas men are seen as more active, competitive, independent and self-confident, unquote. All these issues related to women cause are raised in this drama, hence it can clearly be stated as feminist play. In this play, Pollock has sensitively treated the feminist theme, blending it with emotion so deep that readers and audience have accepted Lizzie's deed, considering her a victim of circumstances. The most important aspect of the play is its randomness of passing from present to past and past to present. She has dramatically linked the past in this incident with a fictional present, which though appears ambiguous sometimes, but it is this quality which makes it different and more interesting than her previous play of the same name, My Name is Lisbeth. This narrative quality and sensitive dialogue makes it one of the outstanding play of Canadian literature. Actually, she wrote this play on an incident, twin murder case, which happened long back. And before she wrote Blood Relation, she has written a play named as My Name is Lisbeth on the same theme. But the narrative technique and characterization was different, and that play was not so successful. So then she thought again and again, and after some time she wrote this play Blood Relation, which became a very successful play. So thank you very much for patiently listening to my lecture, and if you have any doubt of
Dr. Shakminas, Shaista, and you can take the questions now. have a question.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, Manisha Di.
Just as you quoted just now before this, that while the play does touch a feminist issues, Pollock was criticized for making it less of a feminist play and more of a general political play. What is your opinion?
Actually, for I consider it is a feminist play because all the theme related with the feminine issue are raised. If a woman, if a, yes, there is a general topic like if a person gets does not get love and affection from the family, then he or she goes toward anti-social activities. But the main thing is that about property, about insecurity of women, that property in a family is being transferred to the male heir. This was one of the topic, and emancipation of the woman, that was another topic, and then inheritance of property, this was a topic, and then why society does not accept a female criminal, this is also one of the topics. So basically I think it is more of a feminine feminist, and the most important thing is that how Lizzie Borden has dealt all this issue, and she became emancipated.
Thank you so much. And basically what I have studied about Sharon Pollock, she is a historian, you can say. She brings history in her works. Either it is her personal history or the political, that is Canadian history.
And you know, I have requested her to translate this drama into Hindi, and she has allowed me. And I have done almost half of the translation, but after that I lost interest, and the online classes and on everything was going on. So I wish to translate once I'm free from this online classes and all, after one or 1.5 month. So anybody. If anybody has any question, you
that
can
was,
ask.
Very good initiative, and you should complete it. You should do it.
Yes, and we will read it. You will find it very interesting. It is a very interesting drama, like some of our Bollywood movies. I don't remember many other movies. Like we have seen many movies where hero, they commit crime also. Still, we feel sympathy towards them. We consider them victim of circumstances. The same is the case with this play. Abla Jim, do you have any question?
Well, no, not really. But I would like to thank you because I haven't read anything from this writer. So you opened my eyes. And it's very interesting to listen to your comments about it. And I do hope that you will translate that play to Indian language, your language, or in, so that it could be staged. It is interesting. Well, whether it is feminist or not, we may not say it. But nevertheless, apparently what I hear from you, what I understand, correct me if I am wrong. Nevertheless, she brought very important points out so that we can think about that. So, for me, any book, any play cannot be directly imposing the feminist ideas, but they can be still supporting the feminism by bringing the issues out so that we can think about them. So why not that the people are kind of reacting to a female murderer, and what is their reaction to a male murderer? and what is the reaction for being there sentenced or something like that. So for me, to say that a book is really bringing out the feminist issues, if the book or if the play is making me think about the women's issues and women problems, women place in the society, that's enough for me to categorize. And correct me if I am wrong about my ideas.
No, Ablajim, I really wish that you should write on this issue also. Means take this as a theme in one of your novel. Like you have taken issues of very vital importance in our society. So you should take up this theme also. That society rejects women if they commit any kind of crime. At the same time, males are not rejected. Reema ma'am? Ruchi ma'am?
Thank you for the suggestion.
Session was excellent.
Hello. Okay, my mic was mute actually. And I really, Shimnaz, I enjoyed your lecture very much. Now, one thing I just wanted to say was that this is a burning topic, leaving aside the play, which should be discussed in the society very strongly, because unless we change our mindsets, writings won't help unless people's start thinking in another way. Actually, gender sensitization and gender disparities are something which need to be taken up very strongly. Even in our families, we can see these things happening. If we try or don't try, maybe some of us are very very strongly affected by it. Some of us have a subordinate type of feeling about it, but nonetheless, you can find these types of things everywhere in each and every society and every family. So this needs to be changed, and people need to discuss and talk about it more. I think that we should actually, I think, organize this debate on this kind of thing, or make a discussion where we can put our points on the topic. This is, I think, a complete webinar can be done on this. Topic,
sure, ma'am. Sure, we can do on some. Ma'am, we want that people like you should come forward and suggest us and support us and be a leader and guide us, and we can all work together. Simply, me and Manisha Di cannot handle everything. What do you say, Dr. Manisha?
Okay, sure. I think actually, when I was listening to you, I was just thinking that this is something on which we should have a panel discussion so that some things really come out of it. You know, this is a really sensitive topic which needs to be talked about more. Even with the children, young children, they are facing entirely a different, they are in a dilemma. You know, some things are told to them. In the family, others, peer pressure takes them to a different thing, and they are all so confused at the time. So it needs to be, what I think is training the children, training the sons, and training the girls in the family better. So that mindset has to be changed. And people should come forward to talk about it. And I think we will. We need to organize a webinar, and I'll we'll talk to you,
Shanta. Sure, ma'am. Sure, ma'am. Most welcome. Sure, ma'am. Ma'am, we need the support and cooperation from you all. Ruchi ma'am was saying something. Ruchi ma'am, you were saying something.
This topic reminds me of one incident which happened, and one student today. We had the report card distribution, and I had a student whose father committed suicide. And first of all, I was very sympathetic to her, but when she told me that he has tried many times and he was a drunkard, then I told her that you should not be depressed. When he has not given one thought also about you all, then why should you be depressed? You think about your mother and yourself, and be bold and study well.
We need.
So these are also the things which we can't interpret.
We need to make women in our society stronger. What is this criteria of society that still in India also, though women are excelling in different field, lots of women are entrepreneur, they have established as a business woman, but the criteria is that women should be meek, fragile, gentle. She cannot do all the things which males do. So this kind of thinking should be eliminated from our society. Then only we will be able to build a society where there is no gender parity, and then there will be no cases which are happening around us. So Farooq sir has not said anything. Dr. Farooq, I think nobody has any. Farooq sir, have you read this drama before?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I did.
I like this drama very much, sir. I like this drama very much. I like the narrative technique. I like the characterization of Sharon Pollack. I am very much a fan of Sharon Pollack, even Alice Munro. Sir, I want your opinion on this drama and on my lecture also.
Lecture was, you know, undoubtedly good. It was much delivered. Certain points that, you know, I noted could it be in some ways connected with the theory of primogeniture?
Okay.
The theory of primogeniture, which pertains to the eldest of the family, the eldest son of the family, inheriting maximum property, maximum things, you know, from the parents. This theory, if applied to the drama that you have just, you know, delivered upon, seems quite relevant.
Actually, I focus on the inner working of mind of a female. How certain circumstances affect.
There also you were talking, there also we're talking about the inheritance. The inheritance of truth.
Yes, exactly.
Didn't you? Inheritance of truth. So it is in that context only I was referring to this theory of primogeniture.
Okay.
However, at the same time, the issues, you know, that this drama deals with need to be addressed. And the question of mammoth importance that comes is, how do we address those issues? Because, you know, often enough, you know, we organize seminars, conferences, and, you know, a lot of other, you know, say activities, wherein we talk about changing mindset. How do we change the mindset? Because this kind of deliberation has been on and on and on for quite some time now. The fundamental problem with us is we have internalized the patriarchal system so much that, you know, we tend to see man everywhere in the forefront. And men, as the habit with them, are not going to make space for women. So the right has to be asserted by women themselves. So it's for women to come forward. Yes, there will be like-minded, you know, men also. know, somebody said a man cannot be a feminist.
Farooq sir, in India, from the from the medieval time till now, we have seen males being female supporter. So in the case of India, it is different.
Yes, yes, yes.
We have seen Amir Khusro writing about the pains and suffering of women. We have got Raja Ram Mohan Roy, Gandhi Ji, Akbar. They all have fought for the freedom of women, emancipation of women. So our case is different than the Western world. In our cases, males have come forward and supported women right. So that is not the case that men cannot be feminist. I don't agree. We have many examples in Indian context.
Fine. Have you finished?
Yes, yes.
I beg to differ with you because even when a man speaks for women, somewhere down the line, there is a patriarch hidden inside him. It is easy for me to deliver lecture to my students in the class, we should be loyal, we should be faithful, we should be good, this and that, everything, you know, to our parents, to our teachers. But when it comes to applying it to the members of my own family, somewhere I fail. So what you see apparently is something what everybody sees, and thus misses at the point. So something that you have to discover, which is going on within the psyche of a man, what surfaces is not the right thing. The masked beings that we are, it is difficult to unmask these beings. So I am not trying to project a kind of completely negative, a picture of a man, but the reality is there is a patriarch hidden in every man, and that is perhaps the reason why we many a time do not succeed. Though we initiate steps, we fall back on the old ways. So I strongly feel that there has to be a strong emergence of feminine force, a very articulate feminist movement. That is, women themselves should come forward. Many a time you might have seen that when the movement is on, when something good about women is coming, then from among women, some women come out and they say, no, this is not good, they oppose it. So when they oppose it, they become an agent of patriarchy. Women themselves become an agent of patriarchy.
Sir, as an organization, sir, I'm just interrupting, I'm sorry. Sir, as an organization, we are also experiencing when any, our organization is, mostly we have more females member, like me, Dr. Manisha, Manju, Kanupriya and all. Whenever a male, we give a little bit importance to male and he come forward and he see that so many women, like we have Mushine Arda ma'am, Lushila, Annette and Helen. Then they feel ego problem that how these females are leading from the front, how they are ahead of us. So we as an organization, I hope you will not be the one among them. You will support us wholeheartedly. Dr. Manisha, do you want to say anything in this way? Manju?
I'll always be there.
You have not spoken anything. What do you think? Farooq sir will support us or he will also like the male figure having ego problem?
Mushine man wants to say something.
Abla Jim, speak. Shoyle?
If somebody wants to speak. But not Dr. Mirza Ahmed, thank you very much for your ideas. Yes. You have got some points very correctly you told us. Yes, when the feminist women, when we are fighting over for our rights, sometimes yes, we do become a kind of independent feminist. So thank you very much for bringing that issue out. Yes, we need to educate our women, our fellows, in the first place when they become a mother. And I think that women, as feminists, when we are fighting for our rights, we have two fronts to fight. One is against the male chauvinism. The other one, the second one, is the mothers and other women's chauvinism. So we do have two fronts to fight, because unfortunately the women who have never ever thought about these issues are sometimes also fighting against us. And mother-in-laws and a good housewife. I mean, there are some names that we really have to define them, and then we have to really redefine them. For example, what is a housewife? When there is a housewife, why there isn't a husband? We should really bring this one up. I always find another issue between the women, that the fight between the women, that a mother, a good mother or a bad mother. Well, that is a very big between the women, because when we are fighting to be a good mother, then we become very submissive partner of the marriage. So I think that being a mother is not a must for a woman. It is just a plus for a woman. So, all right, we can carry the baby, but we should have a very good father issue. We should bring it that, and then we shouldn't really compete with the other women to become a good mother, to become a good cook.
Thank you, Teshikridiram Ablajim. Now we have Shehnaz Makhan, ma'am. She is saying, she want to say something.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Teshikridiram.
Yes, I quite agree with Mushinada, ma'am, and Dr. Farooq. And I was actually, this point was being raised in my mind again and again, that of course, Lizzie has committed a heinous crime by murdering her father and mother, but don't you think her own stepmother, a woman, is the cause, is the trigger leading to, driving her towards this action? And of course, she has got no support from her sister Emma also. Emma also doesn't understand. Had they given her some moral support, this crime could have been averted. So, and secondly, I feel that it is also, if I think keeping aside this aspect of feminism, you can also look at it from another angle, a struggle, conflict between haves and have-nots. You see, there are two sisters here. Both of them are daughters of the same father, but one is getting support, affection of her parents, and the other daughter is being deprived of it. So one person in the same family...
Ma'am, I just want to interrupt. Okay. Just one thing. Okay. Actually, you have not read the drama that you were seeing. Actually, the problem was that stepmother. She was very cunning, shrewd, but in front of everybody, she was showing herself as a very nice, gentle woman, meek, fragile. So, means like people, double-standard people.
Yes.
those who have something in their heart, those who have double personality, they have something in their heart, but if they speak very softly and very with lots of love. So Lizzie understood that the mother is putting a fake personality. She is not showing her real self. So because of that, she was having a conflict with the lady, her stepmother. And this was the reason that when her stepmother also understood that Lizzie has realized her real self, then and Lizzie understands her better than her husband and her elder stepdaughter. Then in front of Lizzie, she was showing her real self. But in front of her husband and her elder stepdaughter, she was showing her just a fake side. So that is why when she was having a quarrel with the stepmother, and they both used to have quarrel, but when her stepmother used to see her father, she used to project herself as a victim, like we see in our daily soap, Hindi daily soap, Indian daily soap, the same thing. So this was the cause that her father was thinking that Lizzie has become a rebel and Lizzie is all the time fighting with her wife. So actually that is why she was deprived, she felt that she is deprived of love and affection. So this is the
cause. Okay.
Manju, you want to say anything?
No, Dr. Shyamalada, I'm just listening to everybody and that's really great discussion going on.
Shaista?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, Shaista. Now you can conclude the session. Give the vote of thanks.
Thank you. So I again here to present with vote of thanks. Thank you everyone for joining today's session and speaker, especially Dr. Shanaz, giving us with her knowledge. And today's session was one fun for participating.
Thank you everyone for joining us.
Congratulations, Shyam and us.
Thank you, Ablajim. Thank you everyone for joining us. Thank you all the people who have joined us on this platform, and thank you to all those people who have been watching us online on our Facebook page. Thank you very much, and we will be continuing with our more and more event in this.